Hey everyone, George here. Welcome back to the channel. Today we're going to be doing a species profile on what I think has become one of my more favorite fish of all time, and that is the peacock gudgeon. This is a fish that I don't think gets a lot of credit for really being a beautiful asset to any aquarium, 15 gallons or larger. I just think that these fish, as I've gotten to know them, are a particularly beautiful species, and they're very interesting to watch. So we're going to talk about that today, and we're going to get to that in just a second here. Today we're going to be talking about Tateurndina ocellicauda. That is called the peacock gudgeon, and it's one of my very favorite fish. I've fallen in love with this fish, and I've really enjoyed the opportunity to raise some of these fish and to breed them. And give you a little background on my history with these fish. About a year ago, a friend of mine had raised some of these fish and gave them to me. He gave me five of them. He gave me three males and two females, and I've been raising them ever since. Now, one of the things that you need to know about this fish, I do have some notes here that I'm going to refer to occasionally because there's so much about these fish that you need to know about, and I'm not going to be able to remember all of it. They're fascinating little fish, and there's some details in here that I want to make sure that we talk about so that we cover everything that's going to make you have the ability to make an informed decision as to whether or not this is a fish for you. Now, this is a fish in the nano family, so you don't want to put them in a small tank. You want to try to put them in a minimum of a 15 gallon to a 20 gallon tank. Now, I personally am raising mine in a 10 gallon tank. They've been in there a year and they're doing absolutely fine. If you're going to do that, make sure that you're doing really good water changes. Make sure that your water parameters are absolutely top notch, and make sure that it's a well-planted aquarium where these guys have lots of places to hide. And as you can see from parts of the video that are going to be incorporated with this, you're going to see how heavily planted the tank is that I have mine in, and I recommend that you do the same thing. These guys like lots of places to hide. If you don't have a lot of plants and that sort of thing, PVC pipe or small jars, clay jars or whatever that you can find to put in the tank are going to serve just as well as a hiding place for these fish. They really do like to have places where they can feel comfortable and hide. Now, the other important thing about this fish is where they're from. They're from eastern Papua New Guinea. Now, a lot of fish in the rainbow family come from this area as well. These are considered something completely different than the rainbow family. They're not part of that same group, but they are what I consider the only real, what I would call a freshwater goby. Now, they don't behave like a traditional saltwater goby would or freshwater gobies, but these guys look so much like a goby that it's hard to distinguish them from being one or not. So, a couple of the things that you might want to know about the kind of tank that you want to put these guys in. As I said a few minutes ago, you want a heavily planted tank or a tank that has a lot of hiding places inside so that the fish feel comfortable and are able to find places to get away and just sort of be by themselves and find a peaceful place to just sort of relax in the tank. The main thing you don't want is a really harsh current in this tank. They're very much like what I would think maybe as a betta fish, in the sense that they don't like harsh currents. They like their water almost still. Now, I know we have to have filtration, and that's hard to do sometimes, but if you can figure out a way to dial back that that's current in your tank and the water flow, reduce it as much as you possibly can. These fish are going to benefit by that, by being more out in the open and more willing to just sort of be more social with you and interact with you. So make sure that you're dialing back the current in your tank and be really careful to make sure that they're not being blown all over the place, because they're not going to like that at all. It really will affect their stress level and make them extremely uncomfortable in the tank. Now, how do you distinguish a male from a female? There's a couple of different things that are very important. The difference is, number one, size. Males are going to be longer, and they are going to have a much broader length on them, but they're also going to have a couple of other characteristics that is going to be really, really important for you to distinguish the males from the females. Number one, like I said, they're a little bit longer, about 3 inches maximum in growth once they have reached full maturity. Females are going to be somewhere between 2 to 2.5 inches. Now, there is a slight bump on the male's head that distinguishes them from the female. This bump is very prominent, so it's easy to see. It's easy to distinguish between a male and a female in that sense, whereas the female does not have this very prominent bump on their forehead. As they mature, you're going to recognize this, and you're going to know right away the differences between the male and the female. Size usually typically gives it away, but if you're not seeing that, you will definitely know by this little rise on the front of their foreheads on the fish. Now, the other trait that is very dominant on the male is you're going to see a black sort of ribbon on the top and the bottom fins. You're going to see this ribbon run all the way along there, and it's very dominant. You're not going to see that so much on the females. You're going to see that on the males, and it's going to tell you right away that that is a male. The other thing that you're going to notice on the males is that their stomachs are not, they've got the coolest little bellies on these guys. They're very, very interesting to look at. But the male's belly is going to be more of a beige color, whereas the female is going to be sort of a pinkish yellow in color. It's very hard to describe, because the body of the fish itself is like a silvery blue with some lateral red stripes that go down on them. I think there's I think 5 to 6 stripes on the male and 4 to 5 on the female, and that's easily one of the other characteristics that's going to help you determine whether or not you have males and females in your tank. Now, as I said, these fish are from eastern Papua New Guinea, so they are a fish that is found in like very, very slow currents. As I said, these currents are very, very, very slow moving. They're almost like puddles, and they will be in a school, but not in a traditional sense of a school. In other words, they will have characteristics of schooling, but not necessarily schooling in the traditional sense. In other words, they're going to hang around and they're going to shoal together and that sort of thing, but they are not going to do a traditional school. But there will be in the wild a lot of these fish hanging out with each other, so it's very common to see them in the tank sort of grouping together, but not running the tank or anything like that. These fish do not need a ton of room. They are very docile fish. They don't have a lot of speed to them. If anything, I would say that they don't move a lot at all. It's amazing to me that they do move around and they swim around in the tank, but they just don't. They just seem like the most carefree fish that you're ever going to want to see. Now, one of the characteristics that I wanted to talk about, and I'm going to refer to my notes on this because I don't want to get this wrong, but they are sexually polymorphous in the sense that the males are for sure more colorful. They're larger, as I said, and they have that black ribbon running across the bottom there. They have the little lump or bump on the forehead there, or some people call it a hump on the forehead there. And they'll be, like I said, somewhat larger than the female in the sense that they get to be about 3 inches, and the females, I would say, get maximum between 2 to 2.5 inches, and that is really about it. Now, one of the other things that you want to look at on this fish, the fin, the fused pectoral fin, or the lack of a fused pectoral fin, I should say, is seen in a true goby. These guys have this, but it's not actually a goby. It's a fish in the gudgeon family, so it really has its own family of fish that it belongs to. But if you're looking for a fish that's behaves similar to a goby or looks similar to a goby in the freshwater tank, and you want something that's beautiful for a nano tank, this is the ideal fish for you. This fish is absolutely beautiful, and as you're going to see some of the video that I have taken of these fish, you'll see just what I'm saying about the colors and the beauty of these fish. As far as feeding goes, they're predator type feeders in the sense that they like to eat insects and larvae and that sort of thing. Any kind of food is acceptable to these guys. They will take anything from flake to pellets, very, very small pellets, of course, to red worms, to larvae. I like feeding mine a variety of foods because I think it brings out the color in the fish, and the fish seem to really enjoy having a varied diet, and they seem to be a lot healthier because of that. So what you want to do is make sure that you are giving these guys a very sort of good palette of food, I would say, one that is going to give these fish really good health. And again, like I said, they're definitely insect eaters and larvae eaters, so if you can get bug bites or something like that, those are always really great for this kind of fish, and they really, really love it. Now, they're not aggressive eaters. They will not compete with other fish for food. So I recommend that you do these peacock gudgeons in what I would suggest to be a species type tank. That's not to say that you can't put other fish in with them, but you're talking about putting fish in there with them that are probably more like bottom feeders, autosynclids, picosomus. Any of the smaller quarries are going to work great with these guys. They're just not a very competitive fish. So when you're feeding them, if you have competition in the feeding area, this is going to be a problem in the tank. So you really don't want to get into that at all. Now, as far as reproduction goes, these fish are courting type fish. So the male is very much a courting type fish where he will court a female, and you want to make, if you're going to breed these guys, I don't breed mine, but if you're going to breed them, you want to make sure that you've got plenty of hiding spots or caves. If you don't have that in a well-planted tank where there's a lot of rock and areas where these guys can mate and lay their eggs, then you are going to really need to put something in there if you're trying to breed them that is going to put them in a comfort zone of some kind. They love hiding spots. They like to feel comfortable in knowing that they can go someplace and hide and not be out in the open when they don't want to be. That's not to say that they don't like to be out in the open. They do, but if they're wanting to feel secure or whatever, you have to have these hiding spots. What I recommend is small pieces of PVC pipe or small little clay pieces of jar that you can get at most pet stores and put them in there. They'll love those kind of places to hide and hang out, and you'll really enjoy them. Personally, I think a well-planted tank with nice wood and nice rock in there is a perfect environment for these fish, and they're gonna love it a lot more than putting in these PVC pipes and unsightly looking things in the tank. So personally, I like to scape my tanks, and I like the environment to be conducive to the fish sort of showing off the environment for me and the environment showing off the fish. So they complement each other. That's really important. Now, males and females are going to certainly try to mate if you have them in a tank together and you give them the environment where they're going to want to do that. Now, as far as temperatures go, these guys are egg layers. Like I said, they'll spawn between 50 eggs or more, sometimes up to 100, but 50 is pretty average. These fish like, their eggs of these fish like to be oxygenated, so you will see once the female has laid her eggs that the male and the female both will fan them continuously to keep them cool and to keep the oxygenation around the leg or the egg area where they have laid the eggs. As far as captivity goes, they're, you know, like I said, they're a very peaceful fish. So putting them in a tank with fast-moving fish or schooling fish like tetras or something like that, they're just not going to do well at all in some kind of an environment like that. So like I said, I recommend a species-only tank for these guys if you can. If you can't do that, really do your research and figure out what kind of fish will be compatible with these guys and then move to the larger tank. I have these in a 10-gallon because they're strictly... the peacock gudgeons are in there and that is it. But if you want to put them in a more community sized tank, you're going to have to move to something bigger where they're going to have their own territory and not with fish that are fast movers or fish that are going to compete with them heavily for food and that sort of thing. So you just got to be really careful about that. As far as what kind of temperatures these fish like, they seem to thrive in temperatures anywhere from 78 to 82 degrees. Now, the reason for that, I'm not sure why. I think it's probably because of the environment in which they're found in East Papua New Guinea. The waters and tributaries there are very, very slow moving, and so the water temperatures are quite high. And so keeping your tank between 78 and 82 degrees, I run mine right around 80 to 81, and they just love that temperature and they do really, really well. Now, one of the last things I want to talk about with this fish is some of the more enjoyable parts of having these fish, and the thing that I like about them is they're a very interactive fish. So in other words, if you come in to feed them, they're going to come right up to the front of the tank. They're going to move around. They're going to let you know that they're there, and they're going to readily feed, you know, very quickly out of your fingers at the top. I've even had some of mine just take the food right out of my fingers. That's not a normal thing to see a peacock gudgeon do that. They're not known for that. For whatever reason, two of the five that I have like to do that, and it appears to be it's two of the males. So it's kind of a fun thing to do, and I really, really think that if you give these fish a chance in a species-style tank, like I said, give them as big a tank as you possibly can. That's always better for them. You can raise a pair of these or even a couple of pair of these in a 10-gallon well-planted tank, but I recommend that you go for the 15 to 20 gallon size tank, well-planted, and give these guys the best home that you possibly can. So that's my take on the peacock gudgeon. Like I said, I've fallen in love with this fish. I've really enjoyed it over the last year, and it's become one of my favorite tanks that I have in my home. And I think if you are out looking for a fish that really, really is an interesting fish, adds some real nice color and behaviors that you really will enjoy, the peacock gudgeon is the fish for you. So I hope you enjoyed the video. Hit like, subscribe, and comment, please. I love the comments. All the comments help me to understand that you're paying attention to the videos. And if I'm saying something that you disagree with, please leave it in the comments and we'll address it either in a later video or I will get back to you personally. I can't always get back to everyone personally, but I will try to get back to you as best I can. Hit that bell up there so that every time I have a new video come out, you are made aware of it, alerted to it, and you can see some of the great content that we've got coming up over the next few months here. We're going to be doing a 20-gallon cube here next week. We're going to be foliescaping that live, and I hope you'll join me for that. Until then, thanks for watching, and we'll talk again real soon.